So I have been single for quite a few months now. I came out of a relationship just after Christmas. So it was the start of the online dating sagas.
Meet Pam Evans from Aberdeen in Scotland. She's in her 40s, single, and one of millions around the world trying to navigate the world of love and internet dating in the difficult age of lockdown.
I'm on quite a few. I am on Hinge, Tinder, which tends to be my favourite at the moment, and also another one called Bumble, where the girls are supposed to talk first, but the guys never talk back.
Tell me about your dialogue with people now. I mean, how far do you take it? How far are they taking it? What's the new etiquette these days?
So it seems that everybody starts with the how are you, and it's of course, the next question is, are you working? What's your setup at home? Are you alone, or are you with family or friends? I had one guy at the weekend. I'd spoken to him a while ago before, so I knew who he was, and he immediately launched into the we should meet up. I've just been tested last week for COVID, so I know I'm clear. So we should meet up. I'll come round to your house now. And I said, oh no, absolutely not. I'm not breaking lockdown. You know the rules. You shouldn't be doing that. Because I rebutted him, he turned around and just became absolutely abusive straight away. He called me, well, I can't really say the word what he called me because it was disgusting. And you got this abuse verbally just because you were trying to stick to rules. It seems to be that you're either in one camp of breaking the rules or the camp of sticking to the rules.
Yeah, well, welcome to the world of modern online dating, you might say. But the point here isn't just that some people can behave nastily, aggressively, that dating can be unpleasant. It is that there is no simple way forward. Until and as when there's a vaccine for COVID-19, which could be next year, it could be never, let's face it, two strangers aren't going to be able to meet and become intimate without the risk of infection. Or are they? What if someone could prove that they'd already had the disease, therefore that they weren't likely to get it again and to infect anyone else? Reportedly, thousands of people are now using dating websites to advertise this unique selling point about themselves. They've had COVID-19.
Yeah, I've had a couple that have said that to me as well. They're absolutely sure that they've had it. So why can't they just meet up with people, and why should they stay indoors? But at the same time, we don't know how long this immunity could last for. We don't know if it actually is 100% right if you've had those symptoms. And I personally just am not really willing to take those risks.
What are your plans? I mean, let's say next month those restrictions were lifted, you could go and meet somebody socially. How far are you willing to take it right now in the world of dating?
Well, if those rules are lifted, there's no harm in going meeting somebody and sitting having a coffee in a park, or having that interaction with them. I'm not terribly someone who would kiss on the first date anyway. So to me, having that 2 meters apart means that a guy can't lunge on you for once. It's kind of a nice physical barrier there. It's certainly interesting on what would happen going forwards, because you would find yourself having to make some pretty big decisions, taking it beyond those initial dating stages and actually becoming quite a serious and intimate relationship very quickly. I'm not sure if that's something I would want to do or something I could do, but I think that you can't live your life in fear, and that is something that we all have to get our mindsets around.
I believe there are some sites in the US where they're starting to introduce immunity passports as an idea. In other words, they would force people on the sites to sign up, or at least to register whether they had some kind of guaranteed form of antibody tests that they could demonstrate. Do you see it going that way?
Yeah, I can certainly see it going that way. There are certain sites that do that for HIV, so I do not see any reason why you wouldn't do it for COVID.
So if you met a guy and he could prove that he had the antibody test, that he had had the illness at an earlier date, would that reassure you to get into a physical relationship, do you think?
Yeah, I think that that would be the assurances that we would need. It's certainly something that would be more encouraging than taking somebody's word for it.
One woman's thoughts there, Pam Evans in Scotland. Well, dating is one thing, but the appetite among businesses and politicians for some kind of proof of immunity is also growing. Chile is the first country to launch what it describes as release certificates, a document which allows citizens to prove that they've had COVID-19. The UK and Germany seem to be toying with a similar idea. And many businesses, especially airlines, are desperate for the reassurance that this might bring. Could we, should we, be looking at the possible immunity that people get after suffering COVID-19 and make it a tool to make life and business much safer, more bearable, at least for those of us who've had the virus? Let's start with the basic medical facts around this first. Is it true that if you've had the disease and you've subsequently recovered, you are now immune?
Viruses differ in the extent to which you carry immunity having been vaccinated or had an infection. So there are no guarantees that you're going to get, for example, something like you get with polio, which is, you know, you get your vaccination, you get your antibodies, and you're immune for life.
That's Robert West, Professor of Health Psychology and Behavioural Science at University College London. He supports the World Health Organization's view on this, that we cannot bank on the immunity idea. We simply don't know enough about the disease, he says. And even if you carry antibodies for COVID-19, you might still be able to get the illness again, at least after a few months. Most flus, after all, don't grant long-term immunity, he says. Plus, current antibody tests aren't sufficiently accurate.
We don't know an awful lot about them as they would operate in the field because it's when you get them out into the field that all sorts of practical issues come into play and, you know, human operators and so on. The problem here is that they need to be like really, really sensitive and specific in order to be able to do the job. I mean, we're talking in the 99 percentile to be able to do the job that we need them to do. And even if they have above that in a laboratory situation, that doesn't guarantee that that's what it's going to be like when they're rolled out on a mass scale.
If we proceed, though, on the assumption that those of us who have had COVID-19 will be carrying around with us a degree at least of short-term immunity from getting it again, does that not lend itself to the idea that it would be useful for us to know who had and who hadn't had it, who was and who wasn't at least temporarily immune?
The issue really with propositions like what they're calling the immunity passport is that what are you going to do with it? There are so many potential negative spillover effects. False reassurance obviously is one of them. You know, you cannot have a situation where people might have the virus, not be immune, and be able to pass it on to vulnerable groups that they're interacting with. You can't have a situation where people themselves might be putting themselves into harm's way because they think they're immune. Another one is you get, not to put £2 a point on it, fraud. You get people sort of forging these kinds of certificates or certification, which would probably be more likely to be online than anything else. You know, someone is going to do it. And so you have to build in safeguards against that. And that might be quite difficult and expensive. It's not insurmountable, but it has to be looked into. And then a third one is the issue of potential divisiveness within society. If you have people who can go about their business in a much more free, shall we say, way, and that might have implications for what they can earn, what they can do in their leisure time and so on, then potentially that again causes problems. So, you know, these are all hypotheticals, but they obviously have to be taken into consideration.
Professor Robert West, as for the claims that having COVID-19 doesn't provide immunity and that antibody tests are unreliable, not so, according to Franz Walt. He's the chief executive of Quotient, a Swiss firm whose diagnostic system Mosaic is said to be one of the market leaders testing for antibodies.
It has extreme high accuracy. We achieved 100% sensitivity and 99.8% specificity. So that means the probability that you get a false positive is 0.2%.
So that's terrifically good news, I suppose, if people are keen on the antibody test. The challenge put forward by the WHO and others that immunity may not be conferred by having had the virus, by having antibodies, you think that that is being overplayed at the moment?
I can only reflect what I hear and what I see from different experts. And I think there are a lot of experts out there believing that it will provide immunity or a certain degree of immunity. And also the study conducted in South Korea is indicating that there is a certain degree of immunity. Otherwise, there would have been a reinfection. And they also stated that positive tests in the recovered patients were false positives, not reinfections.
Franz Walt of the Swiss diagnostics firm Quotient. So imagine you've had the disease, you can prove you've had it, maybe you can push then to the front of the queue in terms of work opportunities, travel, dates. In parts of the US recently, there were unconfirmed reports of people organising infection parties with this very idea in mind. This was spotted on Facebook recently.
Hi everyone, I have 3 young kids who are currently contagious. If you'd like your kids immunized, let me know. We can make arrangements for a play date. We are full through Tuesday, but have some time Wednesday or Thursday afternoon.
Sound crazy? Well, of course, it isn't even that new an idea, is it? Parents in the US and Europe have been organising chickenpox parties for decades. I think I went to one as a child. There is, in fact, a lesson even further back in history. Back in the 19th century, the citizens of New Orleans at that time had their own killer disease. Yellow fever. It accounted for tens of thousands of deaths, and there were people competing at the time to achieve what was known as acclimation, to be acclimated, in other words, which meant proving they'd had the illness and therefore had immunity. Kathryn Olivarius is a Stanford historian who's been writing a book on this.
I must say that it's a strange thing for a book on epidemics to have so much resonance now that we're in the middle of our own pandemic. Yes, you see very similar patterns taking place now. The way that it is, you know, sort of your imperative to be brave in the face of coronavirus, to get back to work, that those who care about the economy and making sure that the sort of lasting economic depression that's going to come out of this as short as possible, that you see this sort of language of people who are equating going back into society, reopening with a kind of morality. And that's scary because it suggests that history is indeed repeating itself in this regard.
One thing that people do say, don't they, about epidemics across time is that so much depends on the relationship between the population at large and those giving them information, giving them support, giving them advice. Do you see parallels between now and that era of the Deep South in the 19th century?
I think that epidemics and, you know, pandemics don't necessarily sort of create new inequalities. They lay bare the ones that we already have. So you see these epidemics in the past definitely show who belongs and who does not, and that the state, you know, quite literally did not care about you until you were acclimated because it was considered to be a waste of political capital. You know, the rich have always had the benefit of being able to flee. So if you were rich in New Orleans, you can, in the 19th century, and you are a white person, you were free, you could leave town during these epidemics. You could go to your countryside plantations. You could go to New York and conduct business. You could go to London. But if you were poor and if you didn't have the freedom because you were enslaved, you would have no choice as to whether or not you could leave. And that's, I think, you know, we've seen people, you know, rich people in the United States certainly being able to escape to their, you know, second homes or to their, you know, mountainside or seaside retreats, and they bring the disease with them. We'll see how this sort of plays out over the coming, you know, weeks and months as the summer continues.
Professor Kathryn Olivarius of Stanford University.